4, 3, 2, 1. Ladies and gentlemen, may I have your attention, please? The show starts
right here, right now.
Would you like to get my money right? La, la, yeah. La, la, and you can't tell me nothing right.
What?
Excuse me, was you saying something? You can't tell me.
Ha ha, you can't tell me nothing. All right, guys, we are back with another episode of Hog HQ Live. This is episode 21, or 21.
You sure like about how that? I did it?
From a bilingual family, you know how we do it. All right, so this is a collab series. We got a special guest with us tonight. You know these gentlemen over here. I'm going to point that way. Yeah, that's Matt. That guy right there. That's Adam. And the gentleman over there, yeah, at the angle. Yeah. That's Jason Pattyson. Jason, tell us where you are from, what sources and platforms are you on, and how can people see you?
So I'm a contributor to Pig Trail Nation. You'll see all of my stuff that's written over there. I'm also the digital content manager for Hogville.net. And so you can always find all of my stuff at my Twitter handle, which is at DJ Pattyson, or also follow all of our stuff at Hogville.net, also on YouTube, Twitter, and Facebook as well.
Awesome. Appreciate the info. So we're going to jump right into it. We had a whole lot going on this past week. I wish we would have did a midweek show with the whole presser and whatnot. We'll get to that later. As for right now, as the most current news, we're sticking right on football. As of yesterday, you know, we had the spring game or the red and white game, and Pittman actually changed the platform up this year as opposed to going in I know, right? So we finally get an actual game. People can actually tackle to the ground, et cetera, et cetera. I know he won ones against twos, offense, defense, flip-flop with the defense and the offense, and then did some twos on twos and three on threes, two threes, et cetera, swapped it out. Let everybody get some reps. So yesterday was a spring game. For the guys who saw it or attended, it was a great showing by Taylen Green. I mean, I know, let me back up. Let me pump my brakes before we get too excited. Because it's a spring game, right? I told somebody in the comments, I'm like, don't get too hyped. Y'all remember Casey Dick threw 5 touchdowns in the spring game. Like, don't get, right? So at the end of the day, he did have a great showing. What I liked about the overall scrimmage, I got a chance to see a lot of the young guys, get some reps, make some plays, be able to be seen, some flashes of some speed, close in the space on the ball. Taylen Green, I liked about him his accuracy. I think that was one of the biggest things that I took from watching him play. The offensive line won't be elite. It so far looks better than last year. And the running back room. I like the running back room. Of course, we got some news on that as well. But I like the running back room. I like the fact that Jackson, the transfer from Utah, as well as Russell. You got two big backs who run upright. And what I liked about him the most is the forward lane to get the extra yards. And we know DeBinion was in there doing his thing per usual. So with that being said, man, we'll go ahead and do a round robin of what you guys take was on the spring game. Adam, what you got?
Better than years past, obviously. I think a lot of schools, I don't think it's a true test of where everybody was at. Obviously, it's only the spring. Players are going to come and go between now and the fall. I mean, we all saw, or most of the people, if you didn't see Ole Miss, I mean, they basically put on a field day for theirs. I mean, you had a tug of war, you had flag football, you had a dunk contest, you had Joey Chestnut there in a hot dog eating contest. I mean, so awesome. Yeah,
that's the most Ole Miss thing ever, too.
I mean, it is. I mean, props to them. It got them talking about their spring game more than they already would have, but you never know what you're going to get out of these games. I was glad to see that, you know, we really only have 2 injuries at this point. Mm-hmm. Knock on wood. Dozier, I guess, broke his wrist. Yep. And, you know, I was shocked that, you know, because I'm like, receipts, pettiness, saltiness. You know, I still remember after that Missouri game where he's on somebody's Instagram Live asking if Missouri has any spots open.
So, I do remember that. I do remember that.
You know, I don't wish anybody injury or anything, but I was just shocked to even see him still out there. So it is what it is. You know, we saw Braylon Russell towards the end of the game had his touchdown run, which, hey, might as well. I'll just cue it up right quick for y'all.
All right.
Team, do we have the potential to have next season? Can you give him credit to sit there and say, hey, we trust this coach? Oh, here goes our man, Braylon Russell, the minibus.
So I expect to see him. I mean, I don't know if he's going to lean up any. Mm-hmm. I don't think he needs to, though, because you've got your fast backs with Dabinion and whatnot. So I think he's going to be a good basically power replacement for Gustav.
Now, they said the same thing about Rocky when he put on all that weight, ended up getting hurt. So
yeah, but it's a difference between coming in at that versus putting it on in an off season.
Gotcha.
Taylor Green, I mean, like you said, his accuracy was there. He looked good. I was surprised to see, and pleasantly surprised to see KJ Jackson get in and get as many reps as he did.
Yeah.
So, you know, that was good. That's promising to see.
All right, Jason, what you got?
Well, first off, I want to say I'm really glad that they decided to do an actual game scrimmage, because I'm going to tell you what, sitting up in the press box and trying to stat a down and distance that's every other play and they're moving the ball all over the place is horrible to try to stat. So props to the university yesterday for making our jobs a little bit easier. Now, you talked about Rocket Sanders. I mean, we all know the reason why he left was because he saw the writing on the wall. You see Jaquindon Jackson coming in. You see Braylon Russell coming in. Braylon Russell, the difference between him and Rocket came in at 220 mm-hmm. and then put 30 pounds on. Braylon Russell came in at 250. He's been running at this weight, and his body's been adapted to this weight.
Yeah,
so that's why I don't think you're going to see as much injury to him as you would possibly with Rocket. So I think that you're going to see Braylon more at a inside the five type of guy when it comes down to it. Because listen, Jaquindon Jackson's the dude. End of story.
Yep.
And him and Braylon are built pretty much damn near the same.
Yeah.
And it's like two tanks running out there. Then, oh, by the way, Dom Johnson, you gotta think about him. He's actually moving a lot this offseason.
And it's nice seeing running backs actually, you know, catch on a wheel route, not just a screen.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean,
mm-hmm. The offensive line, I wrote about it yesterday. The offensive line, you add in, you know, with Carmona, Blackstock, and Nichols, those three guys have made such a huge difference. I saw multiple times where Carmona on the left side was wrapping up his guy, sealing off the ends, the outside, and his guy, the running back, just running right by untouched. Happened quite a few times. Also, with Kudus and Braun opening up holes in the middle, that guard center guard, when you start getting in the weeds of the SEC, is going to be your bread and butter, because that's where you're going to have to get those tough yards.
Correct.
And that's exactly what they need. And that's what I saw yesterday. Now, Taylen Green, like you said, DP, do not get too far invested. Got to pump the brakes just a little bit. It was a spring game,
right.
But UAPB might be a spring game number two. So you might have to wait till week two to kind of see where he's at, because if Arkansas can get three wins out of the first five games, which by the way, they only have two home games. If they can squeak out three wins, that right there, you're halfway to a bowl, which is great. And I don't want to get out into that, because God knows people are going to check receipts and roast my ass if they have to. But
I hold take off on that. Thanks.
Appreciate that, Adam. Hey, and if they get three wins in that time frame, you've already exceeded or met expectations for Adam. Because that's
I'm not coming off my 3-9. So
We'll have to see. We'll have to see.
Well, you know, last year was 8-4, and look what happened. So.
Well, I said 10 wins too, and I ate crow for quite a while. So, I drank the KJ Dan Enos Kool-Aid, and I drank too much of it.
Yeah, almost, damn.
almost Jones too much. Some of the older guys in there kind of remember that one. Woof, that was bad.
That Kool-Aid to give you diabetes. Leave that shit alone.
Yeah, it will.
What you got? Man, what you got on the spring game?
Just echoing a little bit of like what y'all said, ever since I heard Carmona coming in, my guy had been telling me, he's like, this guy's at minimum a second round pick. He's been giving him nothing but praise. Talking to him today, he was saying that Russell or Dabinia might be our number two running back. Just it's at this point, maybe a toss up. Dabinia might get it just from seniority aspect of it, but Russell brings a physical aspect to it. Adam, would you throw up some of those passing videos up?
That beautiful bean footage. All right.
Yeah, beautiful bean footage.
And now he said that the roles flipped. Sam gets to be on the field. He's the O-line GA out there coaching.
Green will go to the end zone. Did he get both feet in? Did he get foot in? He did! Touchdown, Andrew Armstrong. 20-yard touchdown pass. Another one perfectly placed by Taylen Green.
What a beautiful throw. When you throw those go routes right there, you want the ball coming to the outside, high and outside, to the outside shoulder of the receiver. And Taylen Green right there hanging in the pocket, man coverage, dropping it perfectly.
Now, real quick before you jump back in it, optimistic person in this situation, I'm going to go ahead and say, it was great, great protection by the line, great snap, great accuracy ball with enough air up under it, great catch with the hands by Armstrong. He had a true freshman DB on him. But go ahead. Yeah. I don't want you to get too damn hyped, because once you start telling me, talk to me at the Oklahoma State in the first SEC game. Then you can talk to me about it, but go ahead.
We've been talking about it for couple months, I think, or not a couple months, about a month of the double play or double move and stuff has been a big issue for our cornerback. So the DBs have been a little bit of a something I'm keeping my eye on to see where they really are. And like Jason said, we'll probably really know where they stand come against the second game against Oklahoma State. But I don't want to knock KJ Jefferson, but we haven't seen a pass like that in years. We haven't seen a deep corner fade pass, especially completed, in years, to my recollection. I could be wrong, but I'm trying to pump the brakes, but I feel like we got a guy with a decent arm. He's got deceptive speed like Matt Jones has. That's why a lot of people have compared him to Matt Jones, same height. Matt Jones probably would have had a better arm if he had had that surgery. I believe it's a rotator cuff or something like that, that he needed surgery on. If he had done that, who knows what he really could have been. But I really like where we're at. I think we're going to be improved. But everybody remember when Petrino took over before, we had a slow start offensively. You know, people getting adjusted and learning, but they were coming off of a run-heavy offense and the Wildcat formation, or Wild Hog that they rebranded it to. So just keep that in the back of your mind. But I think if we can get off to a decent start, things could really look up for us.
So a lot of what we talked about so far in just around Robin, I feel like a lot of our discussion has been on the players and what we have via Porter or guys who are currently on the roster. I'm going to go ahead and say it and let it be known. It's Bobby Petrino. The difference between Bobby Petrino and Dan Enos and whoever else, I mean – Kendall Browns was the last guy who was calling great plays. We know people got pissed about trick plays, but shit, when they worked, they worked, and when it didn't, people was pissed. Either way, I think it's something about the sense of urgency and starting fast. Pittman has talked about that in the past. And I'm going to give kudos to Coach Pittman. I'm a Coach Pittman fan. I was before he even got hired. So I said, we need somebody who actually wants to be here. Now, it's been some lackluster years and then some overachieving years. I'm going to give him, you know what I'm saying? But I always feel like this. Pippen has always been a year behind in mastering head coaching. It's always something, whether it's transfer portal, whether it's NIL, whether it's tackling to the ground in spring, whatever it may be. He seemed like he's always been behind. But it seems like, and finally this year, he finally figured it out and said, look, I need to work with the offensive line. Yeah, every damn day. You're supposed to be the guru. I don't want to hear nothing about no offensive line being trash, and giving up all these sacks. That's your job. You the head coach. If you telling me Nick Saban, the greatest football coach who ever did it, he worked with the DBs every day. And you telling me you're supposed to be the guru and can't work with the offensive line? Yeah. So once again, he finally gets it and does it in this year. And hopefully that pays off along with Bob Petrino's system, the way he's able to get these guys acclimated to his set. And one thing I recognize too, I said, let's just be clear. Even if the offensive line isn't elite, Petrino has a system where he's letting the quarterback get the ball out of his hand quickly, which is going to pay dividends as opposed to doing all these five-step drops and waiting for plays to develop and route running. Because let's be clear, them guys that came from D2, they weren't running no best routes. They was getting beat up at the line of scrimmage by the SEC DBs. So all that into account, I'm hoping that we have a great outlook on football. You got to hang 50-plus on UAPB, or I'm not satisfied. That's just me personally. Hang 50. We tried this whole, we're up, we'll just run the ball. The hell with all that shit. Run the ball, score points, keep throwing. As Spurrier said back in the day, hey, her son is on scholarship too. She want to see him play. So I don't care if you got to put in the backups. Keep running it. Keep running up the ball. Put your pedal to the metal, and let's go ahead and make it happen. What you got, Adam?
I was just going to do one more video, and then we can get into some roster changes.
Go ahead with it.
And then after that, you know, I'll put a question up that everybody can answer in the comments, and that'll be something else.
Gotcha.
All right, so here's the next one.
This is that drive concept again. He's going to come. See, number 16 goes underneath. He comes over the top on the dig, goes to the second window. Taylen Green puts it up high for us. You know, where do you want to put the ball when you have a big receiver? Put it up high in the back of the end zone where he can go get it. Nobody else come. He goes, extends, makes the catch, get a foot down.
Did anybody see who Broden caught that ball on?
Your boy.
Oh, interesting. Number 8 is debuting. He's in midseason form. That's what I'm talking about. You're second late, my guy. Hey, I need you to get it together, my guy. I told people, I like how the man get to the ball in regards to the run game. But he's always a step behind. Stop thinking, just play. You got the athletic ability. Put it to use. Make it happen. Side note, before you say something else, did y'all see my guy out there on the field?
Satania?
Nah, on defense.
Huddy.
Who?
Huddy.
Oh, yeah. Oh, Hud Island, number 17. Hud Island, back, baby.
All right. You should have a Hudson Clark jersey at this point.
Hey, man, I'm going to start a fan club. I'm going to start a Stan account. Hey, man. He
is it going to be the Huddy and Cuddy Island?
I'll take it.
All right.
So, you got a question.
Yeah. Well, I didn't know if we wanted to get into, like, a gust of leaving potential others.
Okay, well, go ahead. Yeah. Let's go ahead and talk to it. Go ahead and drop it.
Oh. So, we already know a gust of, after playing the game, entered the portal. I don't know the point of playing in the game, but...
More film.
Yeah, true. But, you know, I guess writing's on the wall of having 4 or 5 deep at running back, that his stock wasn't going to be up there. And then I think Matt might have some others, or even just numbers, not even necessarily names, but there's going to be more coming.
But wait a minute. Adam, you said it's going to be more coming? Is this not what I said last week? And you was like, don't get them started. And I said, you do know.
But the spring game's here and it's already started.
Oh, yeah. I said, ain't no need of you waiting. Yeah. I said, after spring, the spring game, it's immediate. At this point, the emergence of Braylon Russell coming in late and making that push and getting those carries and getting that touchdown, that spoke volumes. So, like you say, I think the young man sitting right on the wall, he's a special back. No matter where he lands, he's going to make an impact. And I seen some of the comments in the group, and I was looking like, it's amazing. These are the same people who was high-fiving and cheering and loving comments and posts when he committed, and you've seen the videos of his highlights. Now all of a sudden he leaves. I see bye. He doesn't want to be. I'm like, y'all childish for that shit. You got to stop that. You got to stop it. But y'all, like, I mean,
if you're gonna go potentially, you got a 12 game season, and you're potentially gonna not play in several of those games because where you're at on the depth chart.
Yeah.
I mean, your time is limited. If you got to go. I mean.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But I'm sure the people that was making those comments are the same people who've been at their job for 35 years that are happy. But hey, what do I know? All right. What you got?
Jason.
Oh, so guys leaving. I'll be honest with you, I don't have very much on that. We already know about Augusta, and like you said, I potentially see him possibly a wide receiver dipping.
We had a tight end leave too. Schumer. What's his name? Schumer?
Shamar?
What? No, not Easton. No.
No.
We had a tight end that left the portal before the spring game. This is like a couple days ago.
Oh. So
research and tag him.
I know. Because, yeah, I don't remember the name, though.
Yeah. Either way, we did have a tight end lead. But you say a possible receiver?
Yeah. So this is one of the things that I kind of want to get, and I think you guys kind of know also. When Sam talks in his press conference and you ask him about numbers and you ask him about players that they're looking for in the portal, which, mine, by the way, they might be looking for a kicker as well.
Yeah.
For a guy that's a one-year guy that can come in and fill the gap until your kicker comes in next year, because that kid is just as good as Cam Little is.
Mm-hmm.
I'll leave that for a different day. But when you hear Sam mention, okay, yeah, we're going to probably take two offensive linemen, which is strictly for depth. You're also looking at defensive line and wide receiver.
Thank you.
When he says those types of things, and you know that Bobby Petrino needs at least 6 to 7 wide receivers, which that's exactly that's right around his go number.
Mm-hmm.
And you have this many already on campus, you know that there's going to be at least one, possibly two leave.
Yeah.
Because the writing's on the wall. You see some guys that aren't getting the looks that they did last year, like Isaac Tisla, Dasmond James. Some names, I'm not speculating. I'm just saying that, you know, hey, you know, look at the tape, because the guys that are getting the throws are the ones that Taylen Green and Bobby Petrino trust, because those are the guys that are on those checkdowns. Because look, Andrew Armstrong, he's going to be your number one in the story. Mm-hmm. And then you also are looking at Isaiah Satania from slot, maybe even a CJ Brown. I mean, that 75-yard pitch and catch yesterday after he smoked those two dudes on the outside, the kid's got some serious speed.
Right.
Mm-hmm. When you start to look at those things, now you got to add in Luke Haas,
mm-hmm.
and you got to add in Braylon Russell and Quindon Jackson.
And
DeBinion. So now you're looking at a numbers game. And like you said with Augustov, you only have so many games that you can play. So now these guys are sitting there kind of looking and saying, you know, I know this is a pass-heavy offense, but do I want to have 3 targets and 1 catch for 12 yards for the next 12 games?
Gotcha. No,
they came here to be the dude.
Right.
Regardless of they're a D2 or not. The difference between Bobby Petrino's and I'm kind of getting in the weeds here for just a second, but the reason why I want to bring this up too is that with Bobby Petrino's offense, whenever he came here back in 2008-2009, he didn't have the wide receivers that he has this year. He's got 5 or 6 guys that have catches at the D1 level during tight situations. Mm-hmm. These are guys that he can lean on. Back then he didn't. This time he does. And so that's where I think that this is a little bit different in that respect. And also with the numbers game, I still think that they're probably out there looking for a guy that could be a solid number 2 on the outside. I'm not saying that Tyrone Broden may not be that guy. I'm just saying that it could happen.
Thank you, Will, in the comments. Tesla is gone. I was trying not to say the hell with it. Y'all showed me all these videos about these one-hand catches at D2. And he was getting his ass whooped at the line of scrimmage last year. He made a couple catches at the beginning of the year. It was nice. It was cute. But at that, he disappeared. So all I'm saying is he's getting lost in the sauce. Maybe he's a guy who has the heart to stay and fight for a roster spot. But as far as getting like snaps and catches, I think he's getting lower on the totem pole in that regard. Matt, go ahead. What you got? And I got something to add about the portal.
Yeah, he struggled with separation has been his big issue.
Right.
And I mean, that was kind of a lot of people the last few years. I'll just throw out a couple of names I've heard, not saying that's going to happen. It's just been thrown around rumblings. It's called a rumor. Broden was one. I'd heard that possibly could leave. Now the family said no. We've seen stories on both ends where family said they weren't going and they stayed, and family saying they weren't going and they left. But the coaches have talked up Broden a lot. His size is definitely useful in the red zone for sure. And going across the middle. So in a way, I feel like that could be a loss if he did leave. I'm not saying he is.
Gotcha.
Another name I heard possibly to look for is Dominique Johnson.
Mm-hmm. I said
it. We're talking about, you know, his window is closing real fast compared to others. So I could not blame him if he wanted to go somewhere else and look. I heard there could – I mean, this was a couple of weeks back or so. I heard that the exodus could have been up to double digits possibly. I don't think it will be, but, you know, we'll see. It's interesting day in football nowadays. You know, you have kids you think are on your team. They're playing the spring game, and then, boom, they're gone that afternoon.
Yeah.
So, I mean, we've got several players from the past after the spring game, so I'm sure we'll probably find some more. We got 5 open spots right now, I believe.
Yeah.
Scholarship spot. So we need to find 6. Yeah, that's right. We just lost one. So we need to definitely fill those, and we'll see what's available in the transfer portal.
All right. So with that being said, a couple of other things that happened this week. One thing specifically that I want to talk on is not on the talking point. War Memorial Stadium. The first game of the season. Hold on. You ready? Yeah. First game of the season. One more. Yeah. Because, you know, they didn't have no water last year. So we're going to bring our own water. All right? Bring our own water.
Just so y'all know, he has been waiting for this.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah, for sure. So, look, the War Memorial Stadium. So, all right, the first game of the year is Arkansas Pine Bluff and War Memorial Stadium. I know a lot of people, and especially being from Central Arkansas, right, I know how big the games or the annuals or biannual years playing at War Memorial Stadium is to people in Central and Southern Arkansas. I get it. I also understand with the whole Calipari situation, I'm flip there to flip back. You mean to tell me we got some people who got some money who ready to write a check for NIL? So we can do it in basketball. You just told me we can do it in football too. With that being said, this is just my suggestion. Don't jump down my throat about it. If you take that money that you spending at Jerry's World, which this is the last year at Jerry, and the money that you spend in to play at War Memorial and invest that on campus, on NIL, and improving the stadium, you're building a better product. It's just like if you're dating two girls. You can't love them the same. You just can't give them all the love equally. It's not going to work. So it just makes sense to me at this point. Let's phase out that phase of dealing with all these extra stadiums where we can't host recruits, which is an issue, and be able to host guys on the campus. Take that money that you were spending, invest it in NIL, so we won't have to worry about tickets going up and all that. Take that money and invest in the NIL for football. That's just my suggestion in that part. What was you about to say? And what was the question you had on that? It was a poll. Do you think the football NIL issue will be fixed?
Well, you know, that's just stemming from with John Tyson stepping up, and now it's, you know, been put out there that the Hunts and Waltons will step up for football. You just have to question how long is that going to take, because, you know, the rumbling, some of the stuff like around some of the players potentially going to hit the portal is a money thing.
It's all about money, huh? NIL is ruining the game. Look, at some point, and I'm not trying to push Sam Pittman out the door because I like him as a person, but he has some growing pains in learning how to be a head coach in the SEC. At some point, whenever we get to the next coach, I'm sure part of their contract will be NIL. See, at this point, the market's been set with the Calipari situation. So you got to do this in football as well, because we know it's possible. We know it's possible. And looking at how we do that, I feel like if we get a coach who says, hey, I want to unite the whole state. I want to see Central and Southern Arkansas and Eastern Arkansas in Fayetteville at these games. You are welcome. We want you here. That would be a whole different vibe, because Calipari came through and he basically ran the press conference. He didn't let them ask no questions. Thursday nights off campus is wild for the university that doesn't want the game taken out of Little Rock. Yeah. That's interesting, Will. That's interesting.
But if you look at it too, I mean, it's a game that got put on TV for moving it to Thursday night.
Yeah. Okay. Okay. That was the only reason why, strictly the only reason why that got moved. Because if not, they were dead set on keeping that thing on Saturday. Then whenever, you know, TV comes around and they say, hey, do you want to be put on? I mean, it's UAPB. That's the difference of ESPN Plus versus ESPNU.
Mm-hmm. So basically, you talk to me about NIL, how it's ruining the game. Sports, media. Yeah, this is all the money.
Yeah.
Well, and everybody needs to realize what's coming with when you're talking about media, streaming, ESPN, you know, with the deal that happened between Disney, who owns ESPN, Fox, US, all them, you know, all sports essentially are going to be onto one platform. Whether that's an app, you're still going to have your games on ESPN, ABC, Fox, NBC, etc. But you're now switching gears to have one basically umbrella for every sport to stream on. Like, so your days of not wanting to stream games, you might as well buy a smart TV or a Roku and get on board, because it's happening, and it's going to be happening by the end of this year, early next year.
Gotcha.
And honestly, that's also opening up the possibility of having an 80 team super league as well. That's the next step, because once you start to get into that, now you're going to start looking at player representation. That's honestly the next step for this, because once you have the disparity on a team of X amount of players not getting any NIL other than a free meal of barbecue, and you got another three or four guys that are getting $200,000-$300,000, a couple more that are getting half a mil. And you sit there and you say, well, okay, the people that are dealing this money out, why are they having such a huge disparity across this entire 85-man roster? Okay, well, now I want to be represented as well. And that's where this is going to come into, because you have to look at the NFL model. That's what the NCAA is slowly moving into. Parts of it are moving faster than others, but at the end of the day, what you see at the NFL is what you're going to see at the NCAA level as well.
Gotcha. I'm looking at some of these comments before we jump into this basketball real quick. They was talking about Petrino and saying, you talked about the players that he had available. Wide receiver-wise, it said that they were young players when he came. Also, that he didn't have full control of the offense at A&M. Now he does at Arkansas. What finally made the Waltons finally step up, asked Will.
A lot of it.
Calipari.
Yeah. I mean, the John Tyson.
Calipari.
John Tyson stepping up for basketball.
Calipari.
Yeah. No, he's a he's a guard at Kansas State.
Oh, okay.
But the other, you know, your Hunts, your Waltons look at it like, okay, the Tysons have alleviated basketball, so now we can put money somewhere else. It was basically a put up or shut up. John Tyson put up his, now the others need to put up theirs.
And that's a gangster move. It's a real gangster move. I love it.
Yeah, because he told Brian Hunt. Yeah, it was, because he said, okay, Brian Hunt, if you want to match me, try. Because now you're going to have to move sports now, because basically John Tyson is going to take over Hunt's seat there on court side now.
Gotcha. What you got, Matt?
Yeah, I mean, that's basically what I was – we got the – like you said, the Hunts, the Waltons are basically doing the football. You got the Tysons and the Stevens kind of doing basketball, because the Hunts were pretty much doing basketball, like Jason just said. Mm-hmm. And it took the pressure off of them. You got Jerry Jones. It's turned into a big pissing contest between billionaires. Well, and they don't
write the damn checks.
Yeah,
exactly. Who's got the bigger stick is basically there you go. What it there is you now.
Go. Yeah.
Well, so, and showers for everybody.
Right. Yeah. So.
Whoa, R. Kelly, easy.
All right. So check it. Teresa. Hey, Teresa. Teresa, my DP don't start. Teresa, you know how I do. Let me see. Scatterfield. Oh, billionaires don't like to be outdone by other billionaires. Absolutely. That's why people who are thousandaires, you don't have anything to say. You live in checking on 401k. You don't have any, you can't get these people business. That's bigger than their business. Let them do what they do, and I'm not mad at it. All right, so check this. Coach Cal.
Wait, before we can ease on.
I know. You have something else. I'm ready for it. Go ahead.
You are? You sure?
I'm ready.
Okay.
I think everybody's going to get a real taste of reality moving forward.
Amen.
We've seen this movie before with Kyle. Where he goes becomes the hotspot. I put Kyle and Deion Sanders in the same category. Deion has the prime effect. It's the same thing with Calipari. Arkansas would now be the hotspot. Arkansas will now have the number one recruiting classes coming in every single year. Arkansas will be full of celebrities. Good luck finding a replacement for Kyle because it's going to be very, very hard. Dan Hurley's not going. Jay Wright is living his best life.
Yes, he is.
Half the work, even more money. He's not leaving. I also saw something about Brad Stevens. You're out your mind if you think he's leaving his position.
Nope.
And then I saw something about Billy Donovan. It's going to be hard to convince any coach that has been to the ultimate level to then take a step down to go to the collegiate level. And it's not the collegiate level of old. This is a brand new monster. To think that it's going to be a line around the door of coaches that want to not only coach at this level, and it's 10 times the amount of work, you now have to meet this standard of being a championship team every single year. What we experienced in those 15 years of Cal being there, we will never experience again. Even when it comes to TV games, the revenue, everything that comes with what kids are looking for in today's time is what's hot, what's cool, what's relevant. I want to be on TV every single night to show my talent. Guess what team's going to be on TV every night? The Arkansas Razorbacks. It'll never be the same.
Yes, sir. And that's Boogie Cousins on Bully Ball podcast. So shout out to Bully Ball for that snippet that went on the internet. He said a mouthful, and I was elated to hear all of it. First of all, if you got Calipari and you put him in the same conversation with Deion Sanders, your next head coach at the University of Arkansas, just call him. Just call him. You interviewed him before. Mm-hmm. Earn a year check. Now he's proven himself to actually have won some games, and he hasn't exceeded expectations. But go ahead and call Deion Sanders making me coach at the end of the day. Said Big Blue Nation calls Boogie a clueless hater. Look, Big Blue Nation is mad at everybody because they got the damn
I have never seen more garbage come out of their fan base than the last couple of days. Their pissing contest today was, look how many people we had at Rupp Arena for his press conference for his introduction.
Yeah, hang the banners. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, I made a comment on Twitter, which I don't usually do, but it was, you know, it's like that person that can't stop posting about their ex that they're supposedly over. Yeah. Just they keep on and keep on and keep on. But it's getting sad at this point.
So Kentucky's the spotted ex-girlfriend is all this is.
Yeah. Right. So check this out. It's interesting. We talked about a comment when we talked about the end of the Musk era, right? As Jay Johnson say in the group, let's be clear. That's my that's my favorite line. I didn't know I said that often. Let's be clear. We talked about Musk leaving Arkansas and going to USC. And the consensus of that statement was, well, why would you leave Arkansas to go to USC? Arkansas is a better job. It has better prestige. It has better history, better lineage of coaches. Now, people are looking at Calipari like, why would you leave Kentucky to go to Arkansas? It's not a better job. You don't have the years of competing for championships year after year. So I'm like, two things can be true at the same time. So the same conversation and feelings you had towards Musk, you got to reverse that and say, look, you blessed and you thankful that you got Calipari to come to Arkansas. Because at the end of the day, we know how this works. The first guy name we heard was Beard. Everybody was hung on Beard, and then all of a sudden it didn't happen. People got upset. They started attacking other people on social media. You said it was going to be true. Now my feelings are hurt. What am I going to do? So it's bananas. And now we got Calipari, and now it's like, oh, we crossing our arms and kicking our feet up and say, watch Arkansas. We all on TV, national network. We took over SEC network the whole day. And I honestly think...
On the national championship day of all days.
On national championship day.
Dwarfed both national championships.
Man was considerate and said he didn't even want the news to leak because he didn't want to take away from those two teams. And he said in that press conference, the information came from here because I didn't say nothing. I said, damn it, that mean Mac. Matt didn't leak the information. They mad at Matt. Madden got the whole world talking about Calipari with the Hall News. That's what happened.
Hey, what was really funny too is whenever Cal said that, he looked right at Wes Moore, because Wes Moore was sitting just across the aisle from me, and Wes Moore looked like he found a turd in a punch bowl. Amen. He was like, he just kind of sat there for just a second. You know, you could tell he kind of wanted to say something, but he really didn't say it because, you know, with the type of media that was in that press conference. Because, I mean, I talked to guys that were from Oklahoma with the Tulsa World. There was people from Memphis and also Little Rock and Kansas City. They had folks here.
Yeah. Yeah, I just seen somebody left a comment talking about why he left. I will agree with part of that about not winning championships lately. I was also told, let me use that phrase, because I was told by a source, and I don't even get into that. But they were also saying, part of the same reason why Musk left here, you won't get along with the boosters, and you start burning bridges. So it's a possibility that same thing was going on in Kentucky, and it was like, get your ass up out of here.
Don't sell me hopes and dreams built on the back of bullshit.
There you go. So look, at the end of the day, when I watched Kyle had a conversation, look, Coach Kyle can sell water to a well. When I tell you he's so smooth, he's slick with the hair, but he's smooth with the words. When I tell you that man can really have a conversation with you and talk you into him, he can rock you to sleep. So just to get the national attention, and I found out this week that a lot of people from the state of Arkansas really just now found out how small Arkansas is to the rest of the world in regards to sports. Like, some people's looking like, what do you mean go to Arkansas? We're looking like, dude, this is why other crews don't want to come here, because of the stereotype. You found out now, we have national pundits who was looking like, you going to go to Arkansas from Kentucky? Now, let's be clear. Ain't nothing in Lexington either. It's the University of Kentucky. Right. But at the same time, you look around, you say, well, but Arkansas, we have this and we have this. And you find a lot of people just fighting for their pride of the state and the school. So you really realize, like, where we really stand on the totem pole of major programs when it comes to D1. What you got, Matt?
Well, some news outlet has voted Fayetteville the best place to live in the SEC for like 10 years straight. So that. I also find it funny that most of the national media was like, well, Arkansas finished, in the bottom tier of the conference this year, but they failed to mention that we were in three straight Sweet 16s and two Elite Eights prior to that, which Kentucky had not been in. So it's the narrative they want to push because they don't want Arkansas to be good or to be, a prominent name. They want to keep the blue bloods and all that stuff. Maybe they just don't want to come to Arkansas to cover it. Who knows? But it's annoying. It's what we've been preaching the whole time. And that's what all these kids, their families, everybody hears that. If you take Calipari's name out and just listen to everything else they said about Arkansas, that's what we've been trying to beat through people's heads, why it's hard to get people to come to Arkansas. Because you have to fight that is ingrained in the back of their mind, that Arkansas sucks. Who wants to go there? Why the hell would Calipari go there? Once you get here, then you understand. Everybody that comes here and leaves, they always say that people are so nice, so hospitable. They take care of you. They love their team. They love their players. And, it's just you have to get them here to really show that. So it's a process, and it's a hard fight. It's an uphill fight. But with Calipari, I think it's going to be much easier on the basketball front, that is.
And then Jason, when y'all hear, like, all the stuff out there from the mainstream media folks that don't understand, don't take it to heart. Just remember what Stephen A. Smith said.
I'm here to tell you right now, we don't care.
Let me tell you
we don't care.
We don't. Hey, look, as always, I said earlier, and I missed it earlier, tell a friend, we are back again. Y'all tag somebody and get them to come in here real quick for this end of these conversations, because you're about to get something that you've been waiting on that you didn't know you was going to get. All right, so once again, tag somebody down below, tag one, tag two. You know what I'm saying? Let them know it's coming. This is what you're here for. If you missed out on anything else, you might want to catch what's coming. So we talked about the Coach Cal era, and we know it's taking off like a rocket. A lot of the conversation that we have, what you got, Adam?
All I did was adjust my hat.
Yeah, well, put your hand down. Put your hand down, sir.
he got that auction tip.
Yeah. All right, so that's what they were talking about NIL. All that for the NIL. But look, at the end of the day, so we talked about Coach Cal. Coach Cal made a comment in the press talking about, I spoke to the roster. There's nobody on the roster. That was a hilarious line. That's going to always be a bit that he had. You got one. And the young man is a 4.0 student.
I vote for Lawson Blake to change his Twitter handle to I Am Legend.
Hey, Lawson Blake, the long person.
Give him a scholarship.
But he's on the roster.
Yeah. Give him a scholarship at this point.
For loyalty.
Well, yeah, I get that.
I mean, No. You're not going to play 13 guys. I mean, you can stand to give one.
No, see, okay, so that's a fine line on everyone gets a trophy. You know how the Ravens did, how they changed the rule book about tackling on the waistline. Y'all got Derrick Henry because y'all got tired
of the hip slip, hip drop.
Are you mad about that?
We're not gonna talk about it. You want to talk?
You want to talk about it?
I don't. What Stephen A. say? We don't care.
Congratulations, you played yourself.
All right, so recruiting. You got one guy on the current roster, another scholarship player. All right. Now, we talk about recruiting, and you seen what Boogie Cousins talked about the possibility of everything just getting bigger and larger in the state of Arkansas in regards to recruiting, because Coach Kyle's here. I don't know if you've seen the clip with Pat Beverly talking about coming back. Dude, Joe Johnson was at the press.
First time in a decade. It's been 10 years since he's been in Bud Walton.
And it's a reason why, and people don't understand that. That's one thing that I admire about other universities, about larger universities who compete for championships. When I see alum on the sideline and courtside and being a part of the program after their days, that's the most wonderful thing. That means the university took care of you in your time that you was there, and you paid it forward and did something for them as well. But you have a good relationship with former players, and that's what it's all about. I learned with the Calipari situation and Mr. Hunt, it was all about relationships. It's all about relationships. At the end of the day, it was all about having good relationships with people and being able to communicate with people in different spaces. In recruiting, what are we looking at in regards to recruiting? We know we got some guys that were currently, that were attached to Kentucky, and now some of those guys are asking out of that NLI. Some of those guys are looking at taking visits to Arkansas and include that in that. And, of course, he talked about portal guys as well as high school guys. So what are we looking like on the recruiting front? Carter Knox.
Let's just put him up here.
Yep.
All right. We got Carter Knox. What do we got going with him? Let me find us. Whoa, there he went. Hold on. Technical difficulties. So he got released from his NLI, correct?
Yeah.
I believe he was one of the first. Mm-hmm. So I know we're looking at him. Cyril, I'm going to assume how you pronounce
it. Santo Cyril.
What you got on him, Matt?
Well, I'll cover that in a minute, but.
Oh, well.
He just wanted to get down how to pronounce it right first.
Okay. Yeah, Billy Richmond.
Mm-hmm. Great job, Adam.
And then Jaden Quaintance. And everybody, okay. So I saw this, like, people are starting to, like, share across X and other places. The Arkansas did not re-offer him. They never took away his offer. So people are reposting him getting his offer from last July, I believe it was. So it's nothing new that has came out.
So Musk was already on him.
Yes. Mm-hmm. There's out of these five guys, there was only two of them that had offers from Arkansas.
Gotcha.
And then who we got? Liam McNeely, he's the one that just most recently got out of his he was the one that was undeclared at this point.
Yeah.
That has Arkansas on it. He's supposed to be visiting Fayetteville, I think, this coming weekend.
Yes.
So he is one to – he's got a lot of highlight tapes out there. Go watch one.
He's a smooth shooter, man. He's super smooth.
I know one I didn't leave or I didn't put on here was the – he played with Quaintance – last night, Boogie I believe, Flan. Or yeah, it was Boogie Fland out of New York. He's still currently committed to Kentucky, but things could change. So, but yeah, there's that.
Boom. So what you got? So we got players, and we're thinking about what he could give. Hopefully, he said he's always staying with his guys. He always believes in developing young players. So it's going to get those parade All-Americans. I'm sorry, McDonald's All-Americans. Basketball players, five-star guys. But he says he's going to also reach into the portal. And I feel like him having a change of pace, a new outlook, can resurge his career in regards to his style of coaching. With that being said, it's also a part of who's on your staff and who you're going to bring. And is anyone that was currently on the Mud staff going to be retained to be on his next staff? Matt, you got something on it?
You want me to go ahead and get into it?
Well, I want to answer this right quick.
Adam got something to say.
Well, I was just going back to Shantae's question here about Pat Bev. So I think there's been a disconnect from when Patrick Beverly left Arkansas. There's been multiple stories out there. Pat Bev's side of the story is somebody wrote an essay for him, put his name on it. They tried clearing it up. He got in trouble for it. He got dismissed from the school. Ever since then, I think Pat not known, like, well, hey, I got kicked out of school, so I probably can't come back. Mm-hmm. Nobody reached out to him to come back. And I think now with all of this, seeing the type of coach that Calipari is, he's kind of like, hey, invite me back. He's not going to do it on his own. He wants the coach to reach out. He's, you know, extended the olive branch, if you will. But he's been wanting to come back. And that's one thing Calipari does is, if you listen further on the Boogie Cousins bully pod, bully ball, he consistently still talks to his former players. I know they mentioned De'Aaron Fox, DeMarcus Cousins. There's several others that he talks to weekly, if not every other week. They still keep in contact. You're going to see these guys, even though they went to Kentucky, coming to visit him at Arkansas. So it's one of those things that a lot of these guys were Calipari guys. They weren't necessarily Kentucky guys.
Right.
So, and then now
can you imagine the pickup games between former Kentucky players that's in the NBA, former Arkansas players that's in the NBA, and current rosters? Do you know what that pickup game gonna look like? It's gonna be crazy. Yeah. You see Anthony Davis and doggone Daniel Gafford and Jalen Williams and Isaiah Joe and Joe Johnson and Pat Bet, like, that's gonna be crazy. But go ahead, what you got on this staff? Is Ronnie Brewer gonna be retained? That's what they want to know.
From what I am hearing, Ronnie Brewer will probably be on the staff.
Now wait a minute. He said will probably. So whoever the hater is waiting to just say that in your draft so you can talk crap if it doesn't happen. Malik Monk will be back in Bud Walton.
He never felt like he was welcome after going to Kentucky. I know.
No, yeah. I mean, between him and his brother, I'm like, man, y'all sold us some wolf tickets. We thought your brother was coming, boy. We was excited. Y'all sold us a bag of goods. Just remember, many people will come here and play for Cal, not for Arkansas, not Hayden. Just don't be shocked by it. Absolutely, I agree with that.
That's what we try to say. Players go for coaches usually, not necessarily institution or program. Right. I mean, some do. Some are just, you know, born a Hog fan. They're going to play for the Hogs. But a lot of them is dependent on the relationship with the coach.
Absolutely.
That's what we've been saying.
All right.
Some other coaches that I expect to probably join the team. Orlando Antigua. And these are all coming from Kentucky. Billy Chin Coleman. Chin is his nickname, in case you don't know.
Yeah,
we got Chuck Martin. I expect Bruiser Flint to be in a special assistant role. John's son, Brad Calipari, like I've always said it before, Calipari, come on, probably as like a development role. And then I have Kenny Payne.
Yes, the Kenny Payne.
That was at Louisville, right?
Yes. So if you look at Kentucky over the last 4 or 5 years, I would say that around that 2020 season when Kenny Payne left is kind of when Kentucky dropped a little bit on their on court. Kenny Payne is that guy, in my opinion. So he left to go to Louisville. That's when a lot of their gameplay just kind of deteriorated, if you will.
Gotcha. Mm-hmm. So we need Kenny.
Yeah.
He's good. Yeah. He's one of those that didn't work out in Louisville. So come back and be an assistant for a coach you know it works with.
All right. Now I'm asking this question, and if I'm not saying no one on here has an answer. This is just me and something that I've seen and I want to know as well. If Ronnie Brewer is retained on this staff, does that mean that he will step down out of an assistant role? Or that all depends on what Calipari wants, who he's bringing in, et cetera.
Okay, well, first, I do wanted to give credit to Jackson Collier at Hogbeat because he did put out an article talking about some of this. But all of this information I'm coming from is from my conversation with my source around 6:30 this evening. Okay. But, yes, I think he will still – I was believing in the beginning that he was going to be more of recruitment player development. But my guy told me this afternoon that, no, he would be a probably be an assistant coach still.
Awesome.
And that the Bruiser Flint would be in a special assistant because you're only allowed 5 assistant coaches, I believe. And then you have kind of special roles for other guys.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And so Brad Calipari and Bruiser Flint will be in some special roles. So that might leave a door open if my numbers are right. But we'll see how it all works out. But that's what I'm expecting is that Ronnie will be an assistant coach still.
Gotcha. Real quick, Adam, can you pull up at some point before we get off? I want to pull up and give my guy a shout out. That what I screenshot you, the comment in the group. I'm gonna call this the quote of the week. Whenever you get it, it's cool.
Yeah, y'all just keep talking.
All right.
Oh, okay. And then yes, Big Z with Kentucky is meeting with Kentucky coaches, I think, tomorrow. But you know, he immediately followed Arkansas basketball. It comes down to if Pope can keep him or does he follow Coach Cal.
Now, for the people that don't know, who is that? The big guy from Croatia.
Well, give I'm going to butcher his name. He's 7'2", freshman. He appeared.
Zvonimir Ivisic.
Sure. So there's probably a cough drop or something named after him. So 15 games this season, he averaged 11 minutes per game, 5.5 points. About 1.5 blocks, about 4 or 5 rebounds, something like that. This is the guy that people look at. You're looking at him for upside.
Mm-hmm.
You're looking at him. He didn't play until I think the Arkansas game was the first game he played in, or the game before Arkansas this last season. So he's one with tremendous upside. It's just getting him to that point.
Gotcha.
Mm-hmm. And then – you want me to go ahead and go into the recruiting part, or do you want me to wait for that?
Let me get into these comments before you jump into that.
All right, okay. We'll say
and
that
then we'll do a round robin of the whole rundown, because I got something that I left out about football recruiting. All right, Emmanuel Bryan says, will we get a lot of great good players coming just to play for Coach Cal? Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Everybody don't love Arkansas, unless you're from the state. What's the connection? So, if opponents thought BWA energy was unmatched before, imagine what it'll be like with Cal and his team that he'll bring. It's going to be crazy. Battle or blocker? I haven't heard anything on that front. I would love for Battle to be one of the pieces that comes back. I would love for blocker just because I feel like it was an unfair circumstance and why he ended up leaving and his playing time and some mishaps or whatnot. I would love to see him be properly coached. By him to watch him grow. Battle is already ready. If you can get somebody that's on Battle's level or better, it just makes the team even more better. And the fact that he already played a year at Arkansas, he knows what Arkansas is all about.
Mm-hmm. Got to play defense, though.
Got to play damn defense. That's for sure. I'll let them shoot. Mm-hmm. We'll finally get to shoot from three. But if we're going to take greater shooting from three and then play less defense, I don't want it. I don't want that. Just give me a blend. Brewer's had connections with schools and AU teams in Arkansas, so I think it is critical. Absolutely. It helps with in-state recruiting, and we talked about it before. 2025 and 2026 is going to be a great year in the state of Arkansas in regards to basketball recruiting. So mm-hmm. it makes sense to have somebody who had great relationships. Go ahead.
I've had some people say that, or some people DM me and stuff asking that they had heard that there may be another ex-Hog, former Hog, joined the staff. That's not matching up with what I'm hearing from my guy. So I don't want to, I do want to dispel that rumor as far as what I'm hearing.
So Cordis Williams ain't coming back? Cordis Williams ain't coming back?
That's what I was like. I was asking him. I was like, who is it?
Scotty Thurman ain't leaving the Cubs.
Or maybe Ty Day being at Flair Smith. I'm like, who is it? If anybody. Right. So, and I will say it's there's a lot of source reconnecting or trying to find new routes into the program because you got a new coach, whole new staff and everything. So it's just building new relationships and stuff, trying to find to get good information out, basically, is what I'm trying to get at. So that's why a lot of this stuff is a little up in the air. But with the recruiting stuff, it sounds my guy seems to be confident on a lot of these players that we'll get into.
So, honestly, those two, speaking of Blocker and Battle, want to go somewhere and play immediately. Cal going to bring in folks. So that will put them in too deep on the bench. Not necessarily. And I'm going to tell you what I think about that comment. And I'm not knocking what you said. But I feel like there's a different level of competition now in practice. You don't have no days off. You don't look at, because you thought about when we seen Musk, we said he going to play seven guys for the most part. So once you was in that seven, you was good. Shit, I mean, you had to work hard. But it was certain days that Musk would get in here and talk about an oppressor about how he didn't like how practice went. Now, he ran those guys. Coach Kyle ain't playing that. It's a dude that's better than you already on the bench. That's a freshman. So you either going to play to your highest ability and have great competition in practice, or your ass ain't going to play. Then Blocker say on IG that he wouldn't return to Arkansas. I seen something. I don't know if that's exactly what he said verbatim.
That's what I'm expecting.
That's what you're expecting. Okay. Yeah. Who's the three players Coach Kyle spoke with? Did we know that?
I don't know, but I'll pretty much tell you from what I was told today, don't expect a former Hog to be on the team.
Okay.
One this past year, except for Blake. That would be the only one that might be retained from what I'm hearing at this point.
Gotcha. Blocker seems to be PO'd. And how his season went his freshman year. If we can fill their spots with better players, it'll be fine. But I'll take Blocker and Battle back. I'm not mad at their comment. I'm saying they were the two of my faves. Absolutely. And speaking of that, hey, comment of the week. I'm going to start a new little segment. It's certain times we go back and forth in these comments. And a lot of times this past week, we've been knowing a lot of information that's came out. And everybody wants to say, oh, I just now seen it, so I'm going to post it. And they may not even recognize it's been posted three times in the group. That's how post approvals come on. With that being said, we kind of work our way through, kind of weed out, so all the comments can get funneled to one comment. This particular comment, somebody tag Austin Farmer. Somebody please tag Austin Farmer so you can know I'm giving him a shout out. So this particular one was about the post he posted, and he wrote it. Matter of fact, I had to look into it. He wrote it. He wrote an article and posted it in the group talking about the football team, spring practice. And something, the headline was something close to, hey, does Arkansas have a potential Heisman Trophy candidate? And Green, the quarterback. It was a whole debacle going back and forth, different people. So at the end of the day, me and him chatting back and forth, and he said, DP, man, there are a fine line between passionate and delusional. And Hog fans ride it like a bike. Man, that was a hell of a comment. That's my comment of the week, man. Shout out to Austin Farmer. Shout out to Austin Farmer for that comment. So every week, depending on what we're talking about in these comments, I'll screenshot one and send it to one of the guys and say, hey, can we pull this up in the show? And I just want to give them a shout out because a lot of times we try to keep the positive energy and keep the negative out. And we know people be in their feelings. But that was a great, clever comment, and I loved it. So that was my comment of the week. Got a couple more, and then you can get into it. Boom. So you saying Battle not coming back? Don't back yourself into a corner.
It's what it looks like with my guy. He didn't sound very optimistic at all. We'll see. But I would say Battle would be the biggest one or the biggest chance, but at this point it seems unlikely from what I'm hearing.
All right. I think Kyle's going to eat in the portal like Tony Soprano in cannoli. That's what's up. What they call him now? They call him, are they calling Kyle the Hog Father now? Is that,
yeah,
is that
what, mm-hmm, Hog Father?
I can dig it. I can dig it. All right, go ahead and run with it.
All right. The players that I will give high likelihood or a very good chance of joining the team. Most of them we just shown you, in case you didn't pay attention. Carter Knox, Billy Richmond, Samto Surreal, Jaden Quintance, and Big Z, Zvonimir Ivicic, are high probabilities to come to Arkansas at this point.
Been practicing that.
Oh, yeah.
I have been. Now I have a 50-50 guy, you could kind of say, a toss-up, and that's Boogie Fland.
Hey, Boogie and, with a hoodie.
Yeah, and here's we talked about Liam McNeely a minute ago.
Yeah.
I've been told that Boogie Fland and Liam McNeely are kind of tied together as friends. Mm-hmm. McNeely is getting approached hard by UConn, so that's a tough one there to go against.
Who just peppered you?
Yeah, if we can get Boogie Fland, there is a good chance we can get Liam McNeely to come to Arkansas as well.
So it seems like they're a package deal for the most part.
Kind of, in a way, kind of does. In a way.
Gotcha. Okay. So we ain't going to hold you guys too long. We're going to go ahead and wrap this thing up. I want to do a round robin of anything that we talked about tonight. If you want to throw out some last minute comments. Before I forget mine, let me say this. We talked about football, spring game, after, and guys hitting the portal. This is my only comment in regards to that particular situation. Coach, if you're listening, coach, if somebody send you this, just know I love you. We love you. We want you to be here, but damn it, we want you to win. You know it's a business. We know it's a business too. I'm going to say this. If you go get some guys in the portal, just consider this, because I always felt like you're a year behind on something. Stop going getting guys for death. Go get you somebody that's going to compete for the starting spot. To hell with that. It's the softest approach to me to say, oh, we just need a couple guys to fill some spots. It's like, to the people that's listening, it's like we've all been in a place of business where we work, and you realize, you're like, who the hell hired this person? You just get warm bodies in the building. To hell with that. Go get you somebody that's some dogs that been competing at a major university and competed in major games, and that can compete with your current starter and make him play harder. That means that practices are harder, which means they are better prepared for games. Don't go get no dudes that we ain't never heard of, and we know that they damn sure ain't going to play. And they're going to be sitting on the bench, and we can say, oh, we got numbers. He ain't going to play. He ain't going to contribute. So I don't want to hear that. I want some grade-A guys who like, damn, we went and got him from that school. He played in the playoff last year. Maybe it was a guy who didn't play in the he wasn't a starter. He was second string. I don't know. Let's go get some guys like that. So that's my comment in that regard to transfer a portal for football. Stop getting warm bodies. Let's get somebody that's gonna compete for the starting spot. Jason, what you got?
I'm gonna go Bob Holt on you guys for a second. I have a two-part. He's notorious for that, by the way.
Yeah.
So first is I'm going to touch on this because I heard this yesterday morning on Marty and McGee. Arkansas was still renting free space on Marty and McGee. They had Jay Billis on. And Jay Billis said Arkansas fans get ready to have a lot of nationally televised games each week because that's the Cal effect, and that Marty Smith is going to basically have to do an Airbnb for the rest of the season here because he's going to get really familiar with a lot of the restaurants around here. So
Catfish Hole, baby, the best catfish and husk pub is in the land. Shout out to the Catfish Hole.
And the second one is with the football team. I really think, and DP, I love your take with the whole not getting warm bodies to fill the holes for depth. Mm-hmm. I wouldn't think that Sam would honestly go out there to put a warm body in a spot.
Gotcha.
Because if he's going to bring him in, he's going to bring him in to start. And he's going to bring them in to compete to start from the get-go.
Okay.
Because, like he said before, if he's not doing that, he's not doing his job right. And to allude to what you said before, he is a year behind on some things.
Mm-hmm.
This, I think he's getting the tutelage in the direction that, you know, Barry Odom gave him before, that Bobby Petrino is now giving him.
Right.
So I don't think he's going to be bringing guys in just for depth. I know I said that earlier, mm-hmm. but at the depth, whenever you make, and when I made that comment, I kind of meant guys that are depth, but can compete to start from the get go.
Yeah.
And so that's kind of where I wanted to kind of clear that up, but I'll hang up and listen.
Long-time listener, first-time caller.
Right.
Yeah, I'm going to put mine towards the athletic department, specifically Hunter Yurachek.
Okay.
We need to get these old players back on campus. Every sport, all the time, they don't need to be charged. If you go watch the 30 for 30 on them, that was something they took pride in doing, was bringing back and bringing knowledge to the younger guys from what they had learned. And that's something we can do by bringing in the Pat Bevs, people other than just Bobby Portis. Not saying I don't like Bobby or anything like that, but the Joe Johnsons, see more of Scotty Thurman when he's available. It just anybody that we can. It seems like it's only tied to regimes or staffs that were kind of recent and, you know, things went all right with.
Yeah.
But we need to bring everybody back that we need to see Nick Smith. We need to see Anthony Black. All of them, past, present, they need to be here on campus for free. Their faces shown. Practicing with the team, working out in the off season like the baseball players do. That's the one sport that I would say we do get it in is baseball. They seem to come back and work out in that nice facility that we had there. Mm-hmm. But we need to start a movement where everybody keeps hounding the program to get them back on campus. We need to see McFadden all the time on the sideline.
Yeah. That's a great point. I remember – bring back Blake Edens. What happened to Blake Edens? I thought he was doing media. Alex Dillon.
Yeah.
Alex Dillon, yeah. I seen Corey Beck.
Blake Edens has been doing stuff with the SEC, with the SEC network. So as far as like color commentary every once in a while. So I think that you should bring back, you should have a spot on Gucci Row etched out for each one of those guys. Anytime they want, we got a night. Okay, I'm sorry, Nick Smith is going to be here this night. What night can you come other than this night? That should be the conversation.
And you know what? And make sure Harold Harris is there too.
I was just going to say that's what Harold said when he came on to see us. Harold said we got to pay for the A club, the fee and all that. And I'm like, dog, players should be able to come back whenever the hell they want and get a pass and be on the sideline and be courtside and just be on the Jumbotron. Do you know what it feels like to see, for a kid to see somebody like Joe Johnson or Corliss Williamson, Alex Dillard, or a guy, a recruit, and you're looking like, damn, dude in the league, he a vet.
Well,
you know what I'm saying?
That's one thing that, you know, years ago with the Bielema staff was Peyton Hillis had let it be known out there that he had never once been asked to come back to the school.
And that's crazy. Yeah.
A guy that was on the cover of Madden.
Right.
Never asked to come back to the school.
Yeah. That's a dope take, man.
Can I throw a quick story out here real quick just before we wrap up? This happened last year at the BAS conference in Springdale. Mart Lamon came back on campus for the first time in 42 years. And he swore to God that he would never step foot back on this campus again because of the way he was treated. Uh-huh. It took Greg Thomas, which, by the way, should be in the Arkansas Sports Hall of Fame, as the winningest quarterback in Arkansas history.
Hey, somebody tag Greg Thomas, because I'm going to hit you in the comment. We got to have you on, Greg. We got to have you on, but go ahead.
Oh, I can wrap that up for you too. Don't worry about that. Oh, I can take care of that for you.
Coach Cap, relationships. We here.
But,
we're here.
Marlon Mond said that he would never step foot back on this campus again. It took his daughter who wanted to come to Arkansas, that had already purchased tickets for him and her and him to come to the Texas game. And multiple calls from Greg Thomas to come back, to finally come back. And Adam, I'll get you that actual thing, because I actually have that on video. Because me and my guy were the only ones there, as far as media goes, that took part of that. And the story is moving. And this is something that should be done across the board, is having former players from different generations step back on this campus and be rewarded and felt love for the blood, sweat, and tears that they poured for these fans. It was a small point in time, but it was part of their life that they still live today.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm.
All right. That's all, Adam. I
got. Sorry, guys.
No, you're good.
You're good. What? Adam, what you got?
I'll just touch on Pro Hogs for a second. You know, shout out to Ricky Council for getting his two-way off the table. He signed a 4-year deal with the 76ers. So no more two-way for him. Jordan Walsh got his first start today. I won't throw out his stats. But, you know, yes, they're in the point of the season that, you know, they're resting guys. Boston's up there in the playoffs, but take what you can get. And then, you know, shout out to Nick Smith Jr., who a lot of folks said that he wasn't ready, and he dropped 24 points today as career high.
Bloop.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's a drop to mic situation. I'm going to read these comments, and we're going to get up out of here, guys. It's getting late. I just want to make sure I don't miss you guys. So I had a bad feeling for football this year, especially if Green goes down. Okay, got it. Is you okay? All right. Now, a majority of Arkansas fans didn't appreciate Nick Smith Jr. Doubt he'd come back, but I agree. They was talking about Shante said Nick never posted anything about Arkansas. The fans were buttholes to him. Absolutely, absolutely. People talk real crazy about dude, but let him make the All-Star game. Like, he went to Arkansas. I'm like, don't do that. It's fake. Dave Van Horn, Steve Atwater. We seen Steve Atwater. What was that in the clip? He was in the suite. I think he asked about Dominique Johnson. That's the only, I think that was the time I remember seeing Atwater. But like, yeah, like up close and personal, we haven't seen Atwater. Malik Monk said, you catch him in Fayetteville now. And that's crazy. So the fact that Kyle is coming, Malik Monk, interesting. I feel like something huge should be done for the 94 team this year. Interesting. Okay. Exactly. He don't fool with Arkansas. How is we treated? Don't post or share anything. Gotcha. Gotcha. Those were that. All right, guys. That was it that I got on these comments. Per usual, Jason, we definitely appreciate you for coming on with us, giving your insight, giving your takes on everything we talked about. Once again, you can let everybody know where they can catch you, catch your content, what platforms you can be on.
Yep. You can follow me on at DJ Pattyson on Twitter. Also, read all of my articles and stuff on hogville.net, also on Pig Trail Nation. And you can watch all of our shows with Dudley Dawson, Otis Kirk on YouTube, that also streams on Twitter and the website hogville.net as well.
Everybody, yeah, I just love how Adam is just that fast. You see the bottom of the screen. You see the man at the bottom of the screen, because Adam is that guy.
Yeah, they're cute.
Once again, guys, we appreciate you guys for watching and hanging in with us. It's Sunday going into Monday. We got work weeks and all that. With that being said, once again, we are forever grateful and thankful for you guys watching us week in and week out. We thank you for interacting in the comments. It's been a blessing to do this week in and week out and be with you guys. Every week we're growing. What was the new number of people that actually joined the group this week? From the time frame,
from like April 6th, something like that.
Yeah, it's 250 since April. Whatever you said.
We're creeping up to 21,000 total.
Gotcha. So with that being said, we're growing, and we're thankful for every single one of you. The dudes who are buttholes, I'm the ones that's deleting your posts and blocking you. Yeah, yeah. Put that in your pipe and smoke it. Don't come over here with the negative energy, man. We like to have a good time. There's nothing wrong with friendly debate and banter. We're not dealing with the foolish. This is not a negative energy space. You can go over that place.
While we were on the show, I deleted and banned somebody for threatening to punch somebody's face or some shit.
It's unnecessary, dude. It's childish. He's a grown man. And it's dudes acting like little girls. With that being said, guys, we appreciate you guys for showing up with us week in, week out. With that being said, you know where you can catch us. We're on Facebook Live, we're on YouTube, and we on the IG. Matt Hart, you got that's got to be your boy. That's got to be your boy. Yeah, that's got to be your boy. Don't flinch. That's got to be your boy. Yeah.
Right. Why is he looking so close?
Hey, man. Zoom in on the man face. Ain't no telling. But look, once again, we on IG. We on YouTube. The YouTube is growing. We thank you guys for going to the YouTube and tapping in with the comments as usual. You can go to the comments if you watch this on the replay. We always chime in on these comments while I'm at work on a Monday. So I look forward to those. With that being said, we are out of here. We appreciate you. Peace.
Peace.